All right. So welcome everyone to our session today on the virtual student federal service internship. I am Antoinette Rothabel. I am one of the diplomats in residence with the U.S. Department of State. More to come later on exactly what that means and how I can be of help to you. But very excited to be hosting today's session on the VSFS. This is the State Department's most flexible internship and can really often be such a great option, such a great choice for students, if for whatever reason they can't go, go in person somewhere, you don't want to disrupt your studies, you have full-time work, part-time work, family obligations, whatever it might be. I think it's just such a wonderful option that we have. And so I'm excited to be talking about it today. A couple of housekeeping things at the top. If you have any questions, please put it in the Q&A, not the chat. We will only be monitoring the Q&A. For questions. So you can go ahead and enter in the Q&A your question either anonymously or share your name with us. We're happy to see that too. But you'll see that the Q&A box is where all the questions should be. And that's where we have some of our colleagues who will help us answer questions there. So please, all questions in the Q&A. We will have a brief presentation at the top going through everything while some of my colleagues are working on the chat questions, on the Q&A questions. But then we can also take additional questions towards the end of the presentation. So I'm going to just ask everyone on the team to give a quick hello and introduction. So again, I'm Antoinette Rothalo. I'm with the U.S. Department of State. I'm what's called a Foreign Service Officer. It's one of the many careers that you can have with us. I've been in the State Department for 20 years now, which I cannot believe. I've served overseas in Australia, Brazil, Afghanistan, Italy, some Washington, D.C. assignments, and then now this assignment in the Southwest as the diplomat in residence, which basically is a regional recruiter. There are 17 of us diplomats in residence nationwide, and we all cover different regions. So I do the recruitment for the Southwest, which is Nevada, Arizona, and New Mexico. And I will share a link at the end, if you're not from one of those three states, of how to get in touch with your diplomat in residence. And again, reminder, all questions, please, in the Q&A, questions in the chat we won't be able to answer. All right, so that's a little bit of a hello and introduction from me. I will turn it over next to my co-presenter, Lindsay, to introduce herself.
Hi, everyone. My name is Lindsay Dussault. I am a sophomore at Arizona State University. I'm actually a current VSFS intern this semester or year. I'm working under Antoinette. So basically, we are just helping to recruit people into different State Department programs. So yeah, thank you all for being here today.
Fantastic. Thank you, Lindsay, for being my co-partner in crime on today's session. All right, next, let's turn it over to another colleague, Haley. Haley, can you please introduce yourself?
All right. Hi, everyone. My name is Haley Martyr. I am a senior at the University of Nevada, Las Vegas. I study political science and world language, so German. I'm also a current virtual intern with Antoinette. It's pretty nice because she's based in Las Vegas, so I get to do some in-person events as well as virtual ones like this.
Fantastic. And one of my esteemed colleagues who actually manages the VSFS program federal government wide, which is a huge undertaking, and she's been a fantastic resource. Gwen, would you like to introduce yourself?
Okay, can you hear me? Great. So my name is Gwen Arredondo, and I am the interim program manager for the VSFS program. We actually have a new program manager starting. She's getting caught up, and her name is Molly Kress, but I have been with the program since the end of June, and I have really enjoyed working on this program, I have VSFS interns myself, and then of course I help manage the interagency. I've been with the State Department about 3 years. I am a contractor, so I've worked with quite a few agencies throughout my career with the federal government. I started out on Capitol Hill, and then I've worked with the Air Force, the Army, Department of Labor, USAID. But State Department was actually always my target. I have a business degree from Ohio University, where I grew up, where I'm from. And then I have a master's in international affairs from American here in the DC area. And then I have I never left. I live here in Northern Virginia, and I am very happy to be here. And I'm going to be helping answer questions in the chat, and looking forward to getting your questions. Thanks.
Thank you so much. And I see we've got a couple of great questions as well already in the chat, some of which we're going to touch on a bit during the presentation. Okay, fantastic. So let's get started. We're here to talk about the Virtual Student Federal Service Internship Program. I mentioned it is our most flexible internship program. It's actually not just the U.S. Department of State that participates, but we'll talk more about that on the next slide. But we are the largest partner, I'm not sure what the word you would use, Gwen, to the largest user consumer of this program.
Yeah. So we have about 60% of our projects are with the State Department. So 40% with in the interagency, but the State Department is the largest. Well, I say partner. It actually is owned. I mean, it was a State Department program initially, and then it expanded interagency. So most of our projects, the majority, are with the State Department.
The other agencies liked what we did with this program and took it on themselves. So it is the U.S. Department of State's only virtual internship program. And it is our only unpaid program, but there are so many flexibilities, and we're going to get into that a little bit, a couple of slides in. So again, it is an unpaid internship, it's a virtual internship, and really just an incredible experience to get, or incredible opportunity to get real world experience while doing something that's just a bit more on your terms and a bit more flexible with, again, coursework, regular work, family obligations, et cetera. All right, so I'll turn it over to Lindsay next.
All right, so what is the VSFS program? So basically, as Antoinette just said, these are virtual internships which are offered by the U.S. State Department and other federal agencies. Most of the internships last an academic year, so September to May, and then students will use their own computer or device to complete a variety of projects, and we'll have more on that later. It's unpaid, but it is eligible for course credit at your college's discretion, so if you have any sort of class where you can sign up for internship credit, this would count for that.
And to the question of which other federal agencies, which I saw in the Q&A, there is a long list, but just as an example, CDC, and this is going to be alphabet soup that I'm going to rattle off here, but CDC participates, USAID, Department of Defense, Department of Education, Department of Labor, FEMA, EPA, which is the Environmental Protection Agency, lots of different federal agencies. So when you go to apply, you can filter by agency if that's your choice, or there are a lot of other ways that you can filter through the projects that are available for applications. I just wanted to respond to that question. Okay.
Yeah, and I just wanted to provide, Antoinette, this current cycle, we have 49 agencies.
Wow, that is incredible. And I think almost 400 projects, is that right? Last time I looked, it was around 400.
We have over 500 active projects. For the next cycle, which the students who are on this call will be applying for, we have currently over 400, and we continue to get projects in. It's technically past the deadline, but we want more projects, so we are allowing the mentors to continue to submit. So I anticipate we'll have well over 400 projects for this next cycle.
Amazing. Very exciting. And I'll talk more about the project-based nature of this internship a little bit down the line. Okay, next slide, please, Lindsay. So who is eligible to participate? Well, one of the many flexibilities with the VSFS program is that basically it's any American college student. So US citizenship is required for all of the State Department careers and student programs. So if you want a job with us, a US citizenship is required. If you want to do an internship, a fellowship with us, US citizenship is also required. So you must be a US citizen at the time of application. You can be a full-time or a part-time student, and either status is fine. All majors are welcome. We have projects that range from every possible topic, and we'll show some examples in a bit. So really, all majors are welcome. I can 99.9% guarantee you, whatever your major is, whatever your interests are, you can find a project that is relevant to what you want to do. You must be in student status for the whole academic year. Because this internship, as Lindsay mentioned, is the whole academic year, fall and spring semester. So you have to be a student for both the upcoming fall and spring semester so that you can participate for the whole period. But you can be studying in the US or overseas, wherever. There's no restriction there. So this is one area where there's a lot of flexibility. Basically, be a US citizen and be a student, a post-secondary college student in the US. So undergrads, grads, we'll talk more about that in the next slide too. Next slide, thank you. So some additional flexibilities. You may have noticed on the previous screen that there was not a listing on minimum GPA required. And there's a nuance here that I'll get to in just a moment. But for the State Department's paid internships, which are all in person, there is a minimum cumulative GPA required that's 3.2. That is not the case for this virtual internship. So no minimum GPA requirement exists here. Now, that said, there may be some projects where the project supervisor is looking for a certain GPA, but that is not all projects. There are many projects that you can apply to without a certain GPA. And then also, because this is virtual, right, you're not accessing any of our facilities, you're not accessing our email systems, you're working on unclassified projects, you do not need to get a security clearance. This is unique to this internship program. All of our other paid internships do require a security clearance, and it's something that takes a number of months to complete, and you have to submit a lot of paperwork to go through that process. So this flexibility with the internship being virtual means you do not have to go through that security clearance process. Another flexibility is the time commitment. So we mentioned that it's a year-long, an academic year-long internship, fall semester and spring semester, but the commitment is only part-time. So it will be a maximum of 10 hours a week. And it could be in some weeks that maybe it's less than that. And of course, the project supervisors are also sensitive to, you know, when you have midterms and when you have finals and things like that. And so you can always work out, you know, a fewer number of hours around those times that are going to be really intense for you as students. So it's a part-time commitment of no more than 10 hours a week throughout the academic year. Of course, probably the main flexibility here is that this internship is virtual, right? So you can do it from anywhere, no matter where you are. You don't have to pick up and move anywhere. You don't have to interrupt your studies or your full-time work, your part-time work, what have you. So that's a huge flexibility here. And then unlike, again, our paid internships, there's no restriction here on what year in school you need to be. So for some of our other internships, you have to be sophomore or above or junior or above or only an undergraduate, et cetera. There are other requirements. For this internship, you can be any year in school from a college freshman to a PhD candidate and everything in between. And we have students who are everything in between. You can even apply right now if you are a high school student who is going to be a college freshman in the 2024-2025 academic year. So you can apply as early as a high school senior or as late as a PhD candidate. And again, everything in between. So undergrads and grads are welcome to apply for this opportunity. Next slide, please. And I think I turn it over to you, Lindsay. Oh, let me just say a note here real quick. Before we go into some examples, I want to mention the structure of this internship because I think this is also another plus. So with the paid internships that are in person, your placement will be assigning you to an office, right? The office that works on human rights, the office that works on climate change, office that works on Africa regional affairs, whatever that might be. And you will help that office with their work on that particular issue. That is not how the virtual internship works. The VSFS program is project-based, meaning the people in the State Department and then some of those other federal agencies participating will submit projects for which they need virtual intern assistance. So the projects are going to be on a number of different topics. I submitted a project last year and I'm submitting this year too, one for folks to help me do recruitment in the Southwest. And actually, Haley, if you can share that link in the chat now, if students are interested in looking at my project, if you're from the Southwest, please take a look at that and see if you'd be interested. So that link will be in the chat shortly. But it's a list of projects, basically. And so as Gwen mentioned, there are hundreds of projects that are listed that you can choose from. And you will be able to select up to five of the top projects that you are most interested in. And so with some internships, you know, sometimes as a student, you wonder, what are they actually going to have me do? What are the responsibilities going to be? And I think a great relief of the VSFS program is that you will already know that going in because you would have already selected these projects as it being of interest to you. So if you get one, you know what you're doing and you already know the description kind of what you'll be engaged in. So I think that's a great opportunity as well. And to give a flavor of what types of projects you might be working on, Lindsay is going to go ahead and share some that she pulled from, again, the 500-ish projects that are already online right now for you to apply towards.
Yeah, so here are just some project examples that I found, and finding these literally took me like 5 minutes because there's so many to choose from. There's so many different cool ones. The first one that I have is Antoinette's project. So this is recruiting the next generation of diplomats in the Southwest. So this is the one that I'm currently a part of. So use your creativity, social media, project management, and communication skills to recruit diverse talent in the Southwest. So yeah, that's mine. But then also, let's say you're interested in social media, US Mission Uganda social media support. Our virtual interns will work on social media content creation, research new tools, digital trends, and develop analytics reports. So if you're like, wow, I really want to get interested in, maybe I'm interested in graphic design or social media or that kind of aspect, that could be an internship that maybe you look at applying for. And then another one that I found was data analytics to support ocean exploration. So the NOAA Ocean Exploration is seeking a VSF intern who is interested in applying data analytics and coding skills to analyze and visualize data that collects in unexplored areas of the ocean. So maybe you're interested, you have some sort of coding skills and you're like, wow, that sounds like a really cool and fun project, something you've never done before. So those are three examples. And then I also quickly just found three more because there are tons and tons of different projects to choose from, like literally anything. If you were looking for something in particular, you probably will be able to find it. So I found one that was speaking Russian with diplomats. So training diplomats for their overseas mission. So if you are like a native or near native Russian speaker, that one could be for you. If you're into history or a history major of some sort, there was transcribing 19th century documents to improve access to older records, which I think sounds really cool. And then also support US diplomacy on cyber and digital policy. So again, if you are like super into like cybersecurity and stuff, that could be for you. So when we say that we have projects for everybody, we really do have projects for everybody.
Fantastic. Thank you. I love the range of those projects, a little bit of everything. Okay, so let's talk about how do you apply to this fabulous opportunity. So let's talk timing first. So the Virtual Student Federal Service Internship Program is open now for application. This is a change in the timeline. Some of you might recall that last year and previous years it opened in July. This year we're opening it in the spring in February, which is great because students are still in school and still paying attention and thinking about, you know, what they want to do for the following semester. So it is open now for application. It opened February 1st, and you have till the end of the month because we're in a leap year this year. That means February 29th. So you have through February 29th to apply. And Haley, if you could put in the chat the link to the main VSFS page, the OpenOps VSFS community, where they will actually go to apply, that would be great. So you can go to the link that Haley's about to share soon, and that's where you would see all of the internships, and that's where you can actually apply. So it's open now, and you have till February 29th. Quick note on the deadline, I believe it's 11:59 p.m. Eastern time on February 29th. So of course, try to get your application in before the last day, but if you are submitting at the last day, be mindful that the deadline is Eastern time, if that's not your time zone. So you have all of February to apply. Then the project mentor, so all of those like myself who submitted a project where we need virtual intern assistance, they'll review all of those who apply, they'll look at your application materials, they'll perhaps interview you. Some project supervisors will, some project supervisors will not. So all of that review will be going on in March and April. And then at the latest, and could happen earlier, but at the latest in May, we will let you know if you were selected. And it could be, you know, if you applied to five projects, it could be that you have an offer from two. Or three. And at that time, you'll have to make a selection. I saw this came up in the Q&A. Can you do more than one project? You cannot. You do have to commit to one project that you're going to work on for the academic year. So you'll receive those offers by the end of May, and then you make the decision and let the project supervisor know if you will be joining the team, that project team for the year. And then when does the internship start? You start in September. You basically start when the school year starts in fall 2024. And then you would do the internship through spring 2025. Next slide, please. And I'll turn it back over to Lindsay.
Yeah. So how do I apply? So applications, as Antoinette said, are open now and close on February 29th. So if you're interested and you want to look at the projects, this is the link right there. I think it's already in the chat. If it's not, Haley will put it in there. And this is the like community page for VSFS. And there's a button that says view internships, and you want to click that one. That's going to populate all of the internships that you can look at. And as was stated before, there's over 400 opportunities. So there's a lot to look at, and I recommend sorting projects. There's like on the side, on the right-hand side, you can sort by skills, languages, or agencies. So if you're really interested in looking for something that deals, you know, with that Russian, if you want to find that Russian one that we looked at before, you can search by Russian, and then all the ones that deal with anything in Russian will come up. So I recommend doing that to search for your projects. You can also just browse all the pages, but there's a lot, so it might be hard to find ones like that. And then once you have searched all through, write a list of just your top five, because I'm pretty sure you're only allowed to apply for five. And so once you've decided, okay, this is one that I want to apply for, you just hit the apply button and then fill out. It tells you everything that you need to fill out and submit for your application.
And on that, the five that you can apply to, there is a ranking feature that you will use. So you will be ranking your priority, and that is visible to the mentors. So in the projects that get a lot of applicants, I do know that it's up to each mentor, but they may start with interviewing the students who ranked their project as the first priority. So you want to think about a couple factors. You want to think about, you can see how many people have applied. Definitely shoot for the stars. You may get that internship where there were 200 applicants. However, if you want to hedge your bets, maybe you want to also apply to one that did not get 200 applicants. So just something to think about there. But the mentors do see, and they do in many cases take into account, what rank you give to the projects.
Yes, and I can confirm that I did start with reviewing the applications of those who listed my project as their number one, and then went to those who listed it as, you know, number two or three, or what have you. Okay, so what do you actually need to submit for this project? And Gwen, I'm going to look to you for a little confirmation here. But these are all of the materials that you should prepare. Now, some of them are mandatory, some of them are highly recommended. I'm going to say, as a project supervisor myself who has reviewed applications, submit all of the things on this slide, and I'll tell you why. So first, you'll want to prepare your most recent school transcript. So that would be whatever transcript you have that went through fall 2023. So that's something you can easily just pull offline now and have that ready to submit. Now, the transcript is helpful for a number of reasons, to see what kinds of things you've been studying. What are your interests? Of course, you know, what are the grades? You don't have to have the 3.2, but just helpful to get a sense of your academic performance and your academic interests and how they might align with the projects that you are applying for. Your resume information will also be very helpful. You can either upload, I believe, a PDF or a Word version of your resume, or you can enter the resume information into kind of the format that's there online. Either is fine. I would say, probably, as again, from the perspective of a project supervisor reviewing things, uploading it is just easier. If you can upload that PDF or upload that Word document and have that ready to go, that's really helpful, again, to get a sense of your interests, what you've done, what your experiences, what kind of skills are you bringing to the table. Then you will also submit some references. I would say at least two. I'll talk more about this in the application tips, but you'll want to submit the names and contact information for a couple people who can speak to your work. And then a required element, another piece, is a statement of interest. Now, this does not need to be, a thesis or a 10-page paper or anything like that. It is brief. There is a maximum. So it is a statement of interest saying why you're applying to the projects that you are applying to. What do you bring to those projects? Why are you interested in them? How does this fit in with your professional educational goals, et cetera? And since you might be applying to up to five projects, you kind of want to make it broad enough to address all of that, and maybe even address specifically why those five projects showed your skills in for each of those in the statement of interest. Again, it's brief, so think about how you want to structure it. But the statement of interest is super important. Again, I'll talk more about that in a minute. And then you want to have that list ready so you can go and select them, the five projects that you are interested in. You are able to apply for up to five after you take a look at the hundreds of options that are in there and you see what you're most interested in. Okay, next slide, please. Application tips. So some of this I was mentioning earlier, but the statement of interest really is, and I would say this is the case for all of our internships and probably anything else that you might apply for in your academic career, that statement of interest, those essays are going to be the most important part of your application. It certainly was for me when I was reviewing who I wanted to take on for my project, that statement of interest really needed to speak to me and to tell me, why are you interested in these particular projects? You know, why VSFS and why this virtual internship, but why these particular projects that you're applying to? And then what are you bringing to these projects? You know, so look and see, what is the project description? What kinds of activities are you going to be doing? What kinds of background are they looking for? And make sure you include that in the statement of interest. So if your project is going to be focused on social media, what social media experience do you have? Anything like that. So you really want to speak to why you're interested in the five projects that you're applying to and what skills, what experience are you bringing, whether that's academic experience or volunteer experience, extracurricular experience, work experience, whatever it is. Experience is experience, so it doesn't really matter. It's just tell me the story of why you're interested in these projects and then what skills you're bringing to these projects that are relevant to the work at hand. Now on the references, I have actually had people include family before as a reference, and sometimes if they're impartial enough, that can work. But really, you want to find people who are not family, ideally at least two. It always looks better. And I have contacted references in all the cycles where I've had a project. I do reach out to the references always before making a final decision. So make sure you select wisely, but I would say have at least two. Three probably for me personally would be ideal, but have at least two quality references, not family, who can speak to your experience, your work ethic, anything that you want to be highlighted about why you would be great for these internship projects. So again, that can be your academic experience, but it could also be your extracurricular experience, your volunteer experience, your work experience. There are a lot of things that we have going on in life, and so draw from all of that. But to have at least two, preferably three, references who are not family who can speak to your work in those areas is strongly advised. Next slide, please. And I'll turn it over to the folks actually in these positions right now.
Yeah, so as you know, hi, I'm Lindsay. I am a current VSF intern. We've talked about that. But basically, I just wanted to share just a brief reason of like why I applied to this internship. So for me, I think one of the biggest things that was awesome was just like the flexibility. Because I am a full-time student, but I also have a part-time job and I have just like a lot of things going on in life. And so I really wanted to do an internship, but I also knew I couldn't commit to something that was in person. I couldn't commit to something that was every single day. I was like, I need something that's going to be flexible and work with my schedule. And then when I found this, I was like, oh my gosh, this is perfect. You know, it's enough experience that I'm actually like gaining something and learning something, but it's also not like almost like taking over my life. And so I found that it was like going to be like a perfect balance for me. And I being in it for the past, you know, however many months it's been, has been really good. I really enjoyed it. I'm glad that I found this opportunity and that I was able to apply. And I think with your applications, I just want to say, like, don't count yourself out until you're out, because I did my internship or my interview for this internship. And I know Antoinette was mentioning, she was like, well, I'm really looking for people who can connect me to others who are gonna, you know, just like bring stuff to the table. And I was like, I don't know if that's me. Like, I don't really know if I have that many connections. Like, am I really the best like candidate? I don't think I'm gonna get picked. And then sure enough, a couple weeks later, I got the email, hey, you were selected. And I was like, awesome. So, you know, don't, you know, count yourself out until it's really over. And then Haley, I don't know if you want to say anything.
Yeah, of course. Like I had mentioned earlier, I'm a senior right now. And so I knew that I wanted some sort of internship, but one that wouldn't completely like ruin, you know, the senior year. It's where you're supposed to kind of have a good time, but still kind of prepare for the adult world, which was really scary. And I actually had a classmate who was a prior VSFS intern with Antoinette as well. And he had let me know all, you know, all the different activities, the opportunities, you know, just everything about it. And it really intrigued me because it was part-time, which I'm interested in because similar to Lindsay, I also have a job as well as being a full-time student on top of other extracurricular activities. So this is a really nice one because it's kind of go at your own pace. It's very relaxed, but I'm still feeling like I'm doing something. So it's not like you're just wasting your time. Like I actually feel like I'm, you know, I'm getting these results. I'm getting these things. I'm helping Antoinette and we're seeing, you know, our work actually has like an outcome, like for example, this meeting. So it is a really like fulfilling, I guess, experience. And I know some of you had asked, you know, are there location like specifics? With Antoinette's, we are based in the Southwest, but that doesn't stop us like from being a virtual intern. I'm originally from the Midwest, so I fly home all the time. I can still work from home. I studied abroad and I was still able to connect with Antoinette and do my work over there. So like I had mentioned, this is really flexible. It leaves a lot of room for you to build off of it as well. And I think that was the most attractive part for me when I applied.
Great. Okay. And then here are just some links that we're going to put in the chat for you guys. So again, students who apply on USA Jobs Open Opportunities, you'll be able to see all the different internships there. If you are interested in maybe like a different path or you want to learn more about VSFS or any sort of opportunity that the Department of State has, you can visit careers.state.gov and we'll also put that one in the chat. And then if you have like specific program questions, like anything that is kind of like super specific to you and you're not sure if we're going to be able to answer it in this call, go ahead and email vsfs@state.gov. They'll be able to handle like case by case questions if you just have something that you're like, this is totally wild and this is not going to apply to anybody else but me. Yeah, so those are some links and we'll go ahead and put those in the chat for you. And then social media. So we do have social media for the VSFF program. So if you have Instagram or Facebook, X, or formerly Twitter, or LinkedIn, these are kind of going to be the ads or the things that you would Google or search for to find us. So if you just want to like screenshot that, if you're interested. Yeah, so those are social media. And then we're going to do a little quiz recap. We just want to make sure that you guys see or like heard all the information. So this is just going to cover the important stuff that we did. So if you've never done Kahoot before, all you're going to do is just take your phone and then just type kahoot.it into your search bar. And then we basically play along. Someone asked how long will it take? It will take like less than 5 minutes. We just want to make sure that you guys like got all the important information. Okay.
And Lindsay, do you have the pin that they need to enter?
Yeah, I'm pulling it up right now.
Okay, fantastic. And if we could put that in the chat too. I'm playing along myself.
Okay. So yes, the game pin is 6204458. I also do not, I'm not sure if there's a limit to the number of people that could be in Kahoot. Oh no. Apparently the player limit is 20 or 10.
We had to use the free version, folks, so
so just play along at home if you're not in the game. I'm so sorry. We're just gonna start it. And I'll read the questions aloud, probably not the answers, but
and you can go ahead and type the answer in the chat if you weren't able to join the Kahoot online.
Yeah, so the VSF internships are all virtual. Okay, yes, so that is true. They are all virtual. There may be some aspects that could be in person, like how Antoinette, when she came to Arizona, like we were able to meet up and do some stuff in person, but for the most part, all virtual. Okay, cool. Nice job, Blair. How long is the internship? Ah, good job. An academic year. Okay, so it's semester to semester. It's September to May. and Blair is still in the lead. Okay, true or false, students work on classified projects which require a security clearance. Ah, good job. We do not have to get a security clearance for this internship. Okay. Next one, what is the average time commitment per week for the VSFS internships? Yes, 10 hours. That would be the max. 10 hours is the max. True or false, the VSF internship can be completed from anywhere in the world. Yep. So you could be studying abroad, living anywhere, as long as you're a US citizen and a student. Which of the following are correct about being eligible to apply? I kind of just answered this one, but that's okay. Yes, so all of the above. So I think some people just saw US citizen and clicked that, but it's all of those things are correct. And Blair is still in the lead. Okay, true or false, VSF internships are unpaid but eligible for course credit. Nice job. That is correct.
And Lindsay, okay. If I could just say a note about that real quick before we go on to the next.
Oh, sorry. We'll do it after this one.
Answering this, but before you show the answer.
Okay.
Now, on that course credit piece, it's really just up to your college's discretion. A lot of the universities and colleges that I visit do have some way to give course credit for some sort of internship or experiential learning. You just have to work with either career services or registrar, whoever handles that at your college, to fill out whatever paperwork is necessary. So that would be on your end. You would have to fill out the paperwork, but many, many universities will give course credit. Thanks, Lindsay.
Yeah, sorry about that. And then minimum GPA to apply for just the overarching VSF internship, there is no minimum GPA. Okay, I think we're two more questions. So VSF applications close on February 29th, true or false?
The folks in the chat are killing it, by the way. Love it.
True, that is correct. They do close on February 29th. Uh-oh, Hannah's coming for Blair. Last question. What is required to submit an application? All of the above. Nice job. All right. Okay, that's the end of the Kahoot. So let's go back. I didn't see who won. I'm pretty sure Blair still won, but okay.
All right, so while we have you here, I wanted to go ahead and mention some of the other State Department internship opportunities, including one that is also open right now for application. So the first one I'll mention is that one of our paid programs, actually all three on this screen in bold are paid or involve some sort of money. But the first one I'll mention is our student internship program. This is a paid internship program that's semester long. You have to have a 3.2 GPA minimum and be a junior or above, meaning also grad student is possible, at the time of the internship in order to apply. So the student internship program is open now for application for the fall 2024 semester. So remember I mentioned for all of our paid internships, which are all in person, we are going to open them quite far in advance of the time you would actually be interning, and that's to get that security clearance because that is required. So for fall 2024, if you want to do the student internship program in person, most of the placements will be in Washington, D.C., but sometimes there's the opportunity to go overseas and do this internship at a U.S. embassy or consulate, which is always fun. So if you are interested, for fall 2024, that is open now through February 9th. And let me actually share my screen. So this, I think we'll just kick off your screen for just a moment, Lindsay. But let me share my screen to show you where you can find some of these things. And please don't mind the bajillion tabs that are open on my laptop. So we're here at careers.state.gov. Let me go ahead and actually just type in careers.state.gov. If you go to internships and fellowships and the dropdown, you will see all of our internships and fellowships. So the one I'm talking about right now is the student internship program. You click here, again, this is in-person paid by semester. If you want to apply for fall 2024, the application is right here, where it says application is here, usajobs.gov. This is where you will actually go to apply for the paid internship. And you'll see here again, the deadline is February 9th. So you have to create an account on usajobs.gov and submit the required information. So for fall 2024, this is open right now for application. And Haley or Lindsay, if you happen to have this link available to put in the chat, you can please say, you know, fall 2024 student internship program link. This is where you would go. Now, you can also apply for some of our other internship programs. So I'm going to highlight some more. One is the U.S. Foreign Service Internship Program. Like, apologies that the names for some of these are so similar, it's hard to tell the difference. But this is more of a deep dive program, and this is only for undergraduates. So why do I say it's a deep dive? Number one, because it's two paid consecutive summer internships with us. One, the first internship would be domestic in Washington, D.C. at our headquarters. The second internship would be overseas at a U.S. embassy or consulate. So you would definitely have both experiences, which is something that both people want to get a feel for what's our domestic work life, work like, and then also the work overseas. So it's two consecutive paid summer internships, but there's also a strong professional development component here. You get assigned a mentor, you have networking opportunities, and then in between those summer internships that you do, you take what's called the Foreign Service Officer Test, which is the first step in the application process to becoming what I am as a Foreign Service Officer. So you're becoming familiar with that application process already as an undergrad. In the best case scenario, you move on to the interview and maybe you've got a job lined up on graduation. But even if you don't pass the written exam, then at least you've taken it, you know what to expect. And if you want to pursue it later, you're much better prepared when you go to study. This U.S. Foreign Service Internship Program, USFSIP, as we call it, will always open in August, normally around the third week of August. Now, you've all signed up in our talent network in order to get the Zoom details for today. As you were signing up, if you did mark that you were interested in internships and fellowships, then you will receive an email when these opportunities open up. If you did not mark that you were interested in internships and fellowships, my strong recommendation is to go back to the registration link wherever you found it and update your profile to mark that you're interested in internships and fellowships, because these things, our paid ones in particular, are only open for a week, right? The other one I mentioned opened February 1st, will close February 9th. This one will only be open for 1 week in August. So highly recommend you sign up with us and note your interest in internships and fellowships so that as these things open up, you get an email direct to your inbox, you know it's ready and you can apply if you want to. So that's the U.S. Foreign Service Internship. Now, another one that I want to mention, and it's easier to find on this page, which is wrangleprogram.org, is the Summer Enrichment Program. The Wrangle Summer Enrichment Program is also only for undergrads. So that U.S. Foreign Service Internship Program one I just mentioned, only for undergrads. You have to be a sophomore or a junior in fall 2024 if you want to apply in August when it opens, and it does require a 3.2 GPA because it's paid. Now, this Wrangle Summer Enrichment Program will also require a 3.2 GPA because it is paid, and you have to be a sophomore or above to apply, so only for undergrads. This Wrangle Summer Enrichment Program is actually closes tonight. It opens around October every year and then closes around this time every year. So it will close tonight for application. But it's not an internship per se. It's really a 6-week summer program in Washington, D.C. I like to refer to it as an international affairs boot camp because that's kind of what it is. So if you're thinking, maybe I want to do something in international affairs, I don't really know what that means, I want to learn more, this can be an incredible opportunity. So this will be a 6-week summer program in Washington, D.C. You'll stay at Howard University, and you will learn a bit about current international affairs issues. You will learn about what some potential international careers are out there. You will talk, of course, to those from the State Department, but maybe you also hear from Peace Corps or USAID or CIA or Department of Defense or whoever else. They have guest speakers each summer from different international agencies and different foreign agencies that work in international affairs. And then also you're learning about what are some grad school programs in international affairs and what are some fellowships that will help pay for those graduate school programs, including our own fellowships. So it's a really just a fulsome experience, a deep dive into international relations and opportunities in that field. It is fully covered, travel, tuition, the housing, everything. In addition, for the Wrangle Summer Enrichment Program, the scholars last year got $3,300 as a stipend to pay for expenses, food, what have you, for their 6 weeks in Washington, D.C. I always joke with students as an undergraduate student and even as a graduate student, my whole 6 years of post-secondary education, I did not have $3,000 to spend on food for 6 years. And these students get $3,000 to spend on food for 6 weeks. So it's a pretty amazing experience. I will also just briefly note that in addition to internships, we do have fellowships. So if you go back here to internships and fellowships, I want to highlight these four that are called Foreign Service Fellowships. These are all career pipeline fellowships. And what does that mean? It means we are going to pay for 2 years of your education. In most cases, that will be a two-year master's degree. And you have a guaranteed job as a diplomat when you graduate. Huge opportunity. I actually joined the State Department through one of these, through the Pickering program many years ago when there was only the Pickering program, but now we have four fellowships, which is wonderful. And for these, because we are giving you money, you do have to have demonstrated financial need. You have to have the 3.2. You would typically apply in your senior year, but you can take a look on careers.state.gov and explore these a bit more. Where they differ is what kind of degree you need to be studying and then what career you would join as. So you can explore to see if maybe these are possible for you. And these are also opportunities where we are particularly encouraging those who have been underrepresented in the Foreign Service for too long to apply. So whether that's those with disabilities or diversity in many of the ways in which it can manifest, we would love to see some candidates from those fields, but you definitely have to have some level of demonstrated financial need for graduate school since we are giving you all this money. If you can otherwise pay for grad school, then go for it, and that's wonderful. And then you can just apply to any of the careers separately. So I did want to share this information just because there are a lot of student opportunities, but again, careers.state.gov, look at internships and fellowships, look at the career paths. And one thing that I will, we'll mention in a bit when we go to the next slide. So let me stop my share now.
Antoinette, we had a question that I wasn't able to answer, and we get this quite often, and I do share the Pathways programs because we get the answer for VSFS specifically, what if a student is graduating in the fall? What if a student is going to be graduating here this current spring and they're not eligible? But I know the Pathways programs are for a recent graduate, so I do share that information. I really just share the link because I'm not a recruiter and I don't have a lot of information, but wondering if you have more information or can share about those programs for recent graduates.
Sure. So you can also find that on our careers.state.gov page. We have what are called Pathways internships where you can be a current student or you can be a recent graduate. Most of our Pathways, they're all paid. They're all sort of like mini jobs, basically. Most of them are going to be in Washington, D.C. And so that's why I don't mention it as much in the Southwest unless you are able to go and be in D.C. for a semester for a year. But we do have sometimes Pathways internships available at our passport agencies across the country. So in my region, there's just one passport agency, which is in Tucson. There's one very close to Las Cruces in El Paso. But so mostly the Pathways will be in Washington, D.C. or at the passport agencies across the U.S. I would say also please go back to your registration form and mark that you're interested in Pathways if you are, because you have to really be on the mailing list for that. So you know when these things open up. You would get an email like midnight of the day that they open up, and they often have a cap, the first 50 people to apply, the first 100 people to apply. So you've got to be ready, to go online, submit your resume as soon as possible. So it can be a bit of a moving target, the Pathways, but also an incredible experience to have a paid job, basically, while you're in school or if you're a recent graduate. But again, mostly in Washington, D.C., but that's another opportunity. Thank you, Gwen. And Lindsay, if you could go back to sharing your screen, please.
Yes.
Make sure I covered everything. The student internship program open now. And I hope my colleagues put in the chat that USA Jobs link for it. Trying to see. Oh, they put the careers.state.gov link. But if you use that, if you just scroll down there, the link to USA Jobs is there, as I showed in the screen share. So that's open now. US Foreign Service Internship Program will open in August if you're going to be a sophomore or junior in August. And then the Rainbow Summer Enrichment Program will open again for application next fall. And then, of course, there are those four fellowships.
Antoinette, we have one other question that I think you will be able to answer. How are fellowships different from internships?
Sure. So with the internships, you're getting some experience now as a student, but there is no guaranteed job with the U.S. Department of State afterwards. This is just one internship that you will do. Maybe you decide to apply for a career with us. Or maybe you don't. Hopefully you have an amazing experience regardless, but it's one sort of isolated internship program with us. With the fellowships, they are all career pipelines. So if you apply for one of the fellowships and you get it, you will join the U.S. Department of State when you graduate. Again, it will just depend on which kind of career you have, depending on which fellowship you're going for. But the fellowships will also involve some internships. So with my fellowship, the Pickering Fellowship, there were two paid summer internships. All the fellowships offer two paid summer internships. The first one domestic, the second one overseas. There's also professional development. You get assigned a mentor, you have an orientation program, a couple of different things. But so the difference is that with the fellowships, we're paying for your education. Number one, that's a huge difference. and then number two, you have, you know, a career with us when you graduate, which is huge. As long as you've completed the program and the fellowship requirements successfully, you have to maintain the 3.2 throughout your graduate education, for example. As long as you've completed those program elements successfully, then you will be hired by the U.S. Department of State when you graduate. Okay, next slide, please. And where do you go? And if you have questions from here, Haley, if we could put that vsfs@state.gov email in the chat again. If you have nuanced questions about your particular application for VSFS or your particular eligibility for VSFS, please do reach out to vsfs@state.gov for sort of more specific programs about your case and being eligible for the VSFS internship. If you have more general questions just about State Department careers, State Department internships, fellowships, other opportunities with us, we also have study abroad scholarships. The Gilman Scholarship, for example, is open right now for application. If you want to do study abroad and you're a Pell Grant recipient, that's open now and will close March 7th. And in fact, if there's a chance, maybe Haley, if you could Google Gilman Scholarship and pull up that link and we can share that in the chat, that would be great. So if you are in the Southwest, if you are studying in Nevada, Arizona, or New Mexico, I am the person that you can reach out to. So remember, again, I'm the diplomat in residence for the Southwest, but I also have diplomat in residence colleagues who cover other areas of the United States. But if you're in my region, which is, again, Nevada, Arizona, or New Mexico, you can email me at dirsouthwest@state.gov. If you are not in my region, if you are elsewhere, and Haley, if you could put this link in the chat as well, the Connect with a Diplomat link, go to careers.state.gov, and then there's a tab at the top that says Connect with a Diplomat. Find the state that you're in to see which diplomat residence covers your region. Click on them, and then there's a little button to email them right under their picture, and that email goes directly to their inbox. So you can email them if you're, you know, from Pennsylvania, Ohio, wherever. Go on there on that link, find who represents you, and then email that diplomat residence with any questions you may have. Also, I do want to share for those who are in my region, and I suppose even for those who are not, we recently, as diplomats in residence, all started official LinkedIn pages. Some of us had personal pages, but now we have official LinkedIn pages. I'm going to share mine here. This is my official Department of State Diplomat in Residence page. Please don't look for Antoinette Hurtado LinkedIn, because that will take you to a separate page. You'd have to look for Diplomat in Residence Southwest, and that is the official page that I just sent you. That is where I and the other diplomats in residence, if you want to look for the LinkedIn page for your diplomat in residence, that's where we're going to post things in real time. So as soon as that student internship program opened up on February 1st, I posted it on LinkedIn. As soon as the VSFS opened up on February 1st, I also posted that on LinkedIn. I post job opportunities when they open up, information sessions when they are advertised. I'll put all of that on LinkedIn. So if you want to follow me there at my diplomat in residence Southwest LinkedIn page, you are welcome to. And again, that will be the real-time way to kind of stay up to date with our opportunities. Is there another slide, Lindsay, or is that the final slide?
That is it. I did have a question. Some people are asking if it's possible to get the Zoom recording. So are we going to be sending that out?
But we are recording here today in the hopes that we can eventually get that on the careers.state.gov website. So if you go to careers.state.gov, in fact, let me go on this journey with you, because I want to show you something here real quick. Let me share my screen. Sorry, Lance, I'm gonna kick you out for a second on the screen sharing. If you go to careers.state.gov, so again, we're at this main page, and you go to career paths, and then recruitment events, recorded events. I highly recommend you take a look at this, especially if you're interested in the careers, because under recorded events, we have videos from past information sessions that range through everything from how do you prepare for the Foreign Service Officer Test, which is a written exam that's offered 3 times a year. That's that first step to becoming what I am as a Foreign Service Officer. Do you want to meet people in the different specialties? So, oops, sorry. Do you want to learn what it is to be a construction engineer with us, to be a general services officer with us? We celebrated First Generation Day. We had a presentation on that. Women at the State Department, we have a series on that. National Native American Heritage Month, that's actually me. Right, so I moderated that panel. Actually, I'm moderating a panel tomorrow on Afro-Latinidad at the State Department, and we'll have a couple of wonderful Afro-Latino colleagues who are Foreign Service and Civil Service who will be joining that. So there's a series of videos here that are really helpful about careers, also some about student programs. This is one I did here, everything you ever wanted to know about the Pickering and Rangel Fellowships. You can watch that. So again, lots of really helpful information here about our different careers and just about our workforce and other things, videos for U.S. Foreign Service internship program. If you are all interested in that, I would take a look at this webinar that we offered last year because that will open for application in August. So recorded events have a wealth of videos here. We hope that this video will also eventually be placed here, but it will probably take some time. But here is where you can look again, recorded events under career paths, recruitment events, recorded events. All right. Any other final questions we're seeing that have not already been addressed in the Q&A?
I actually have one more opportunity. It's with someone we partner with an organization that the VSFS program partners with. It's the Robertson Foundation for Government. I can put the information in the chat, but they offer fellowships for students pursuing a master's degree in four specific universities. Two of them are actually in the Southwest, but it's for students who are pursuing master's degree in international relations, policy, and related fields. So you would apply to either UC San Diego, Texas A&M in the Southwest region, that also Syracuse or the University of Maryland, but it provides a fellowship. So as Antoinette was mentioning, pays for your studies and you apply to those schools, but then you indicate that you are interested in the fellowship. And then, so it's just a program to help support employment with the federal government. So I will I'll put that in the chat for you. Something that if you're interested in a master's programs at those schools, this may be something that you might be interested in.
Thank you. Fantastic. So then Haley, if we could leave as the last things in the chat, the link to the VSFS main page, the open opportunities page, where they would go to apply and actually see all the projects. You can put that in the chat. And then if we could, for my Southwest students, put one more time in the chat the link to my project if you want to help me do recruitment next year. As Lindsay and Haley have been doing with me this year, I'm going to be looking for probably two or three students to do this with me next year as well. But again, there are so many projects, whatever your major is, whatever your interests are, there will be something, I promise, that will suit your interests. Okay, Lindsay, Haley, any last thing in the chat that we should address? And Gwen, anything else you wanted to add about VSFS? Any other maybe tips on applying? Or I love what Lindsay said earlier about really don't count yourself out. Don't not apply. And sorry for the double negative, but not apply because you think that, you don't have the exact experience they're looking for. I mean, a lot of what I'm looking for and probably other project supervisors too is, initiative. Do they seem excited? And will they do the hard work? You can learn, about subject matters, but it's hard to learn interpersonal skills and to learn, excitement and initiative. And so these are things I'm looking for as well in the interview process, not just the hard skills to actually do the project itself. So don't count yourself out. We are looking for a lot of different things when we're reviewing applications for these projects. But let me first go to Gwen for any final thoughts, tips, and then Lindsay, Haley, let me know if there's anything else in the chat we should address.
Yeah, so two more things that, to keep in mind. One very important tip, the last 2 years, the procrastinators who apply at the last minute crashed the system. Okay, so you will potentially see in the past, we have extended the deadline. Do not expect that will happen. If the system crashes, we will take that into consideration. But I would encourage you not to wait until the last day because you will be sitting there at very late probably in the evening, frustrated that the website is down. So keep that in mind. Don't wait until the very last day to apply. Actually, I have three things. The second thing is you are able to withdraw your application if something else, as I mentioned, projects are still coming in. So if you apply to your five and you change your mind and you want to change that around, you are able to withdraw and apply to a different internship. Now I don't remember what the third thing was. Oh, I know what it is. We have a feature this year where students will apply to their five, up to five. And after that initial round of offers, if mentors are still looking for students, they will be able to look in the database of students who haven't been matched. So what that means is if you apply and you are not offered an internship, you may be contacted. You won't be able to apply again to any other internships, but mentors might contact you from projects from which you did not apply, but they may reach out to you to see if you might be interested in their internship. By and large, if you have not heard by May, that means that you may not be selected for this year. I won't say it's impossible, but we think that most of the internships will be filled by May. One other thing is we get this question a lot. What if you're ready to start earlier? As far as the program is concerned, we aren't going to limit the time that you're working with your mentor. So if you want to start early and your mentor is able to support you, you can start in the summer, you can start in August. Maybe you do not need time to get settled in at school and you don't need to wait until after Labor Day. If that's the case, please just communicate once you've been selected that you're available to start earlier. And if mutually agreeable between the student and the mentor, you may be able to start before September.
Thank you so much for mentioning those last two items in particular. If you do not get selected for one of the top, you know, five projects that you did apply for, please do know, as Gwen just said, sometimes, you know, project supervisors, they didn't want to accept, you know, anyone that they saw who applied for their project. And so they'll look for others and they'll look at your statement of interest, they'll look at their resume and see who else could be a good fit. So it's not over till it's over. And then there is flexibility on the start and end time. Like I asked my students if they felt comfortable, you know, starting in August, because they were all starting school really in August and they were all ready to go in August. So the four current virtual interns that I have all started in August. And I haven't asked them yet, but I will see if maybe at least one or two want to stay on until maybe June, July, and help with a couple summer things. But absolutely, it's a conversation you have with your project supervisor, the start and the end times of the project. Lindsay, Haley, anything else in the Q&A chat that you think is big that we should address?
I just wanted to reconfirm. Someone asked, just to double check, there are no opportunities for any permanent residents, right? Every opportunity for Department of State requires U.S. citizenship?
Correct. U.S. citizenship is required.
Yeah, I don't know. I think we covered a lot of super awesome things. I wish you all great luck in applying for your VSF internships or any of the State Department opportunities. I think they're all really great. And I'm sure we have a lot of great people in this bunch.
So I actually do have a resource for students who are not U.S. citizens. I'm looking for it right now. Aha. Nope, that's not it. I will, please, if you had that question, can you just email me, vsfs@state.gov? And I can provide you with a resource if you do not hold U.S. citizenship. Not with the State Department, of course, but with another organization.
I was just going to ask for that clarification. Yes.
Yep.
Yes, for the State Department, all of our opportunities do require U.S. citizenship. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, I will thank my team for helping me to co-host and to deliver and manage the session today. And I will thank all of you who joined us. I hope you found this opportunity interesting. And I hope to definitely see some of you apply for the projects, hopefully for mine as well. But for all of these opportunities, the paid internships, the virtual one, there again, so many opportunities with the U.S. Department of State. So thank you so much for joining us. hope to see you applying. We'll go ahead and stop the recording, and I wish everyone well, and we'll conclude today's session. Thanks so much, all.